It's nice to talk to you. How are you?
I'm quite well.
So we're talking about this Transangelic Exodus record, which the first two songs I've heard so far have been fantastic. It sounds really good.
Well, thank you.
Well, I'll start with your quotes on this. As I read from the press release, it says, you know, not a concept album, but a cluster of stories on a theme. And I was wondering if you could talk about the theme just a little bit.
Well, there's more than one theme, I suppose, but I think it's about being a queer outlaw or feeling like that. There is this backstory that I sort of invented that shows up a little bit in multiple songs, which is about I'm in love with an angel, somebody who grew wings and turned into an angel, and the government is like after us because angels are illegal, and harboring angels is illegal. And I was writing all about that. I was writing more songs about it, and I just kind of decided you don't really need to know anything about this whole dystopian backstory I created. I think the songs really explain themselves anyway. The point is, the album is set in a car on the run from authorities. Me and an angel driving around.
I mean, it's a cool idea. It's a cool concept, whether, you know, we're calling it a concept. The concept in itself is a really cool kind of take on everything. And it's not, obviously, it's not hard to see the parallels with what are going on in society and around the world right now. And I guess the obvious question is that what I'm looking at right now with that idea?
Yeah, it is supposed to resonate with, like, the feeling of paranoia that various groups are feeling, that in America is feeling more vulnerable in a moment of, like, increased hate crimes and hate speech. And what looks to me like more both like a political atmosphere and like legislative things on the ground that are threatening to a bunch of different groups of people, actually. Mm-hmm. Non-white people, I think, most of all, possibly. And yeah, also queer people of various stripes. And basically anyone who felt vulnerable before our president came to power, they feel way more vulnerable. And I count myself among those people. And it's reflected in the record. Sort of fear of authoritarianism and white supremacy and hatred of queer people. Right. Becoming institutionalized, more institutionalized or like sanctioned.
It's obviously time to make a statement for an artist. This is what I'm hopeful from the artists that I'm fans of, that, you know, that they use the platform and use the podium that they have. And, you know, with what you've written and how you've written it, I kind of do see, like, I know there's a challenge when you're trying to put all this together, when any artist is trying to put all this together, of sort of not being, I don't know, lost in the plot or you know, I know a lot of artists try not to be completely on the nose. You know, you want to put it some form of art.
Yeah. And
okay, so that was kind of on your mind as well?
Well, the album is really not my act of activism, principally. I mean, it maybe counts as some kind of activism, but it's not really the goal. I think the goal of a piece of art is, for me, it's usually to show a way to myself and to my audience of how to be human, how to be alive to just the emotional realities of the world right now. I think to be like a really vibrant and alive American today, you have to be kind of disturbed, politically disturbed. So I guess what I'm trying to say is the record being about these political themes is just because those are like raging in my heart, and whatever is raging in my heart is what I make records about.
I mean, that's the thing. You write what you know. That's what everybody says. You write what you know.
Yeah, or what you feel and what feels important or urgent. That's what comes, you
know,
out.
I know that press release where you had said, you know, fiction and half true memoir. And I thought, you know, in a way, isn't that every song? I mean, even when you're writing fiction, it's half a truth because of what you just said right there.
Yeah, that may be so. I think I was also thinking of this as a piece of writing that, I mean, I always wanted to be a prose writer, and I'm working on that a little bit. I used to want to be a novelist, but I think what I turned out to be good at is writing songs. This is something like it's an attempt kind of at writing like a postmodern novel, but in songs. And, you know, if that makes it sound pretentious, well, maybe it's pretentious. I'm a proud, pretentious. I mean, yeah, I just think that's, you make good art by being pretentious a lot of the time. So I don't care if people throw that at me.
Musically, and I do want to do that side of the coin too, because, you know, you had been quoted saying, you know, Big Fugitive Life was the end of a chapter musically, and which leads me to believe that when you went into this, it was definitely a whole different ballgame for you.
Yeah, me and my band, over the course of a few records, we were a certain kind of band, and we had a certain kind of goal. It was all kind of sort of a love letter to old soul music and old punk rock, and being that kind of band that can just like rough and ready rock and roll outfit. I just feel like we did that quite well. I mean, if you were to like see us live anytime, like 2014 through 2016, we really kind of were hitting a ceiling in terms of what I wanted to do. I felt like we were exactly, but you know, that's listening to old records and loving those old records. And then the more you listen to records coming out now in an era where amazing records are coming out, like Yeezus was really inspiring to me, and this last Vampire Weekend record, Modern Vampires of the City, like they're just using technology and just to make amazing things happen. And I was sort of just like, we could be doing that. We definitely could be doing that. And maybe we'd have our own special take on it. Maybe we can make something that sounds not like a love letter to an older kind of music, but is sort of keeping up with the vanguard of the sounds being made this year. Yeah, it also just felt like an unexpressed part of my musical personality. I love chopped up stuff, weird, surprising sounds. Like what is that crazy thing that comes in? Or like that kind of stuff.
You definitely get that. I mean, driving downtown LA being, you know, the first little listen from this record, and you get that huge musical change right into the chorus. I mean, that's an announcement right there. Like, you had just done the little fun thing online where you know, the boyfriends are dead, you know, long live the visions, you know, and kind of made everybody for a surprise there. And then you come out with driving downtown LA. I mean, yeah, it's noticeable everywhere.
I'm just quite proud of them, how weird and interesting sounding they are to me. But we'll see. We'll see what people think when it comes out. And then the name change felt like, it just felt like we had become a different project with a different goal. So we wanted to change our name. It's the same members of the band, to be honest.
Yeah. You know, with no disrespect to the rest of the band, you know, as long as your name is up there on front, then I think we're all game.
That's a choice. That's a choice to keep my name up front. It has its reasons. I know it's egocentric, but that's me, baby.
I do want to compliment you, though. Your attention to melody has always been so impressive, you know, and I take that compliment back several albums ago, but, it, you know, still showing itself on here, especially with the new single, I Love You So Bad. And I don't know, it's kind of wondering, and maybe you've already answered that by talking about sort of, you know, that style of music that you love to hearken to, but is there anything specifically that you attribute that talent to with the melody that you have?
With melody? See, I'm gratified to hear you say that, because there have been people who have said, like, you know, a lot of the time you're just yelling. And I there are songs where I'm just yelling stuff, and it's not about, at least the vocal melody. And then I always am like, I got to write a melody. I really love certain masters of melody, like Paul McCartney and Paul Simon. And like, it's quite a thing when you start to notice what a melody does. Like, the reason you love a song is due to its like melody, it having a very distinctive melody or wistful melody. I was worried it was a dying art. I think I read an interview with Paul Simon where he was like, nobody can write melody anymore. The age of melodies is over and people can't really do it anymore. So I'm just doing rhythm stuff and melodies are gone. And I was kind of like, screw you, Paul Simon. I can write a melody. Let's go. So I have been working on that specifically. I'm glad you've noticed.
No, it's definitely noticeable. Like I said, you know, I take it back. I still go to, you know, the My Hero song and just how insanely catchy that is vocally. And again, I throw the same thing out here with the new single as well. I mean, it's, you know, that old cliche of the phrase earworm, it is exactly that. So you have excelled, succeeded.
I love worms.
Well, there you go. That's the headline for the interview right here. That's the poll quote.
Since I was a child, always loved worms.
Ezra, I really do. I love this. I love the record. I can't wait to hear the rest of the record. I love these singles so far. So thank you so much for giving me your thoughts on it.
Oh, it's certainly my pleasure. Thanks for having me. Thanks for playing my music.
I appreciate it, and have a great year and holidays and whatever that means to you out there. And we'll see you around.
Yeah, you too.
All right, see you.
Bye.